Easily regarded as one of the most celebrated samurai, Yagyu Jubei Mitsuyoshi has been... You know what?
What?
You know what, can we just back up a little bit more, just for context?
I don't know about that.
I know it's another side tangent and everything off of Ninja Scroll, but it's not like Jubei was just some guy. I mean, his family was a pretty big deal, and his historical lineage and place in history is kind of worth taking a minute to talk about, I think.
That's the only sensible answer, isn't it?
Okay, before the year 1600, Japan was comprised of hundreds of warring states. The Yagyu family was one of the feudal lords, or daimyos. When Japan was united under one shogun for the first time in 1603, the Edo period began the longest era of peace for the country, over 260 years. And all these soldiers had no wars to fight.
Survive a war, you gotta become war.
So they would wander or become bodyguards for hire, and this is where we would get all the biggest folk hero names from Japan. Hattori Hanzo, Miyamoto Musashi, and of course Yagyu Jubei. Similar to historical Western legends like Billy the Kid or Wyatt Earp. They're based in historical fact, but then exaggerated into legend.
You called down the thunder, well now you've got it!
The Yagyu family stayed close to the shogun and became the official sword masters of the shogun himself. Their style of Yagyu Shinkage Ryu, which translates to Yagyu New Shadow School, is still practiced today. The idea is to win by taking initiative.
Yagyu Shinkage Ryu nazo.
What is this? Intermission or what?
No, I just think it's interesting. Like, one of their styles is based on fighting a sword with bare hands. It's called Muto, and you catch the sword in your bare hands.
Really?
Well, that's what they say. Anyway, Yagyu Jubei became a sword instructor by the age of 24, and he either didn't like his job teaching, or maybe he hit someone that he wasn't supposed to, or...
Is there a point to all this, or what?
Yeah, he was fired, and he leaves to become a wandering ronin. Although, that part could just be romanticized.
Who gives a shit?
Well, boner, that's what makes Jubei such a great character and fodder for anime and manga and movies and everything.
Great. Let's have it.
The missing time. Look, the official report is that he goes back to his village and lives a peaceful life, and he's like falconing and has a heart attack and dies, and it's all noble and everything. But there's like 12 years with no official accounts for where he was and what he was doing. And some people think that he was a spy for the government.
A Tokugawa government spy wants to hire me?
The Yagyu clan is often portrayed in these movies as an intelligence agency for the shogun, or even an assassin's guild sometimes.
Either one sounds okay to me.
There's also the issue of whether or not he lost an eye. Some say he did in a match against his father using a wooden boken. Some say that he didn't, and if you look at the portraits of the time, they're shown with him having two eyes, so maybe that's just romanticized, something that makes him seem a little cooler to us. Maybe it never happened. But whether or not it's true, we're gonna see this scene replayed time and time again.
Ah! Ah!
Do not smile!
Ah!
Jubei!
Father!
Jubei has actually been portrayed on screen since 1959, and there are literally hundreds of portrayals and movies and TV series, and it would take forever if we were to explore them all, so we're gonna have to pare it down.
I don't know what to do!
I'm gonna tell you what we're gonna do.
What did you have in mind?
We're just gonna focus on the Sonny Chiba movies. I mean, those are the movies that are most likely to influence Ninja Scroll, and that's what we're here for, right?
That's your little game, is it?
Was that not clear? I mean, I'm titling these things Ninja Scroll and we're in chapter 2. Anyway, Chiba plays Jubei in 4 movies, 1 TV movie, and 91 episodes of television.
Not bad.
Right? I mean, it's damn near iconic. Sonny Chiba was a superstar in Japan in the 70s. America wasn't going to give him his due until 2003 when Tarantino put him in Kill Bill.
It's not right and it's not fucking fair. Why should that surprise anybody? When the hell has America, you know, ever been fair? You know, we might be right every once in a while, but we're very rarely fair.
I agree completely, and I don't want to cut you off, but we don't want to get sidetracked again, right?
For our purposes, promptness is far behind thoroughness.
Now, the samurai genre in Japan is kind of running on fumes by the time we get to the end of the 70s. Still, in 1978, Sonny Chiba played Yagyu Jubei in Shogun Samurai, or the Yagyu Clan Conspiracy. This movie's like the last big charge up the hill for the genre. It's got a star-studded cast, stellar production, and it sweeps Japan's Academy Awards winning 5.
Level 5?
Level 5!
And Toshiro Mifune is in it? I mean, that's Akira Kurosawa's guy. If you know anything about Japanese cinema, samurai, chambara films, or just film in general, you know who Akira Kurosawa is. And Toshiro Mifune is like a national treasure in Japan. Hiroyuki Sanada from the original Ringu and Tetsuro Tanba from You Only Live Twice both also feature in this movie. I mean, this thing's like a DC who's who of Japanese actors. You're just going down the filmography going like, oh, this person was in Lady Snowblood 2, and this guy played Jubei in one movie and Hattori Hanzo in a different production, and it just goes on and on. You add Chiba to the mix, and this is like the Expendables of its day. And then also the flute player, who immediately caught my eye as being in one of my favorite American ninja movies, 1994's The Hunted with Christopher Lambert.
Anja.
Which I know is blasphemy because he masters the ninja sword over like a weekend doing the white savior thing. But it's also got some awesome ninja stuff in it, and Joan Chen is totally wicked as well.
I wish to die slowly and with much pain, so I remember what it was to be alive.
Anyway, the irascible, ultra-intense samurai dad is the same guy here. It's just 16 years apart.
It's
true.
Director Kinji Fukasako made one other Yagyu Jubei vehicle for Sonny Chiba in 1981, Samurai Reincarnation. Also worth mentioning that 22 years later, he directed Battle Royale. Pretty cool.
Now you're talking.
The movie tells the story of who is going to rule in the shogun's death, which of the two sons. It's historical fact who became the shogun, but this movie kind of opens the door to sort of a behind-the-scenes how this all happened and fell into place. We also get to see the moment when Jubei loses his eye in this movie as well. The movie's a phenomenon. You want to know how deeply felt its influence is all these decades later?
All we want to know is what's going down.
Okay. So, Chiba goes on to play the character in 39 episodes of the TV show, and for the pilot, Fukasaku himself comes to direct it, and they look over the original script for the movie and find things that were sort of cut out of it, lines that they never used. In the opening of each episode, Chiba would recite the secret family Yagyu doctrine. I don't think I can say it, because if I read it out loud, it's going to sound stupid coming out of my mouth.
Oh, I think it can. I have faith in you.
All right, Dean. Thanks for the support, brother. Let's see. In the original movie, it's, "This is the path I'm destined to follow. I'll kill my parents if they stand in my way. I'll defeat Buddha if he interferes. I'll follow the path of no return."
I like it.
Well, they rewrote it for the TV series, so then it became, And then 3 years later, in Fukasaku's Samurai Reincarnation, and 25 years later, Tarantino would have Chiba say something similar in Kill Bill, only as Hattori Hanzo. Now we're going to look at Samurai Reincarnation in Chapter 4, okay? But before we move on and look at Futaro Yamada, the author, let's just take a look at one more influence of movies from the 70s.
Don't you think you've already done enough?
Not even close. let's briefly talk about Lone Wolf and Cub. Based on the manga, Lone Wolf and Cub was turned into a series of 6 movies, all celebrated and loved.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.
Should we take a second here and talk about Lone Wolf and Cub the manga? I mean, it's easily as influential as a comic as the movies were to other cinema. I mean, without the manga, you wouldn't even have Frank Miller evolving his style, which has crazy ramifications for American comics. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Usagi Yojimbo, Lone Goat and Kid. But we should move on, right? I mean, you said that you wanted to move as quickly as plausible, right?
As quickly as possible, I said.
Oh, well, that makes more sense. Okay, well, let's leave the comic there and just focus on the movies, and I'll try and keep this pretty concise.
Well, you better make sure it's that way.
The setup's pretty simple. The Shogun's royal executioner is betrayed by the villainous members of the Yagyu clan. After murdering his wife and setting him up to be a traitor, Ogami Ito sets off with his son Daigoro to walk the road of hell, as he often says, in 6 movies. The first 4 movies came out in 1972, with the 5th and the 6th movies coming out in the next 2 years. When the franchise hit America, they had edited the first 2 movies together into a new movie called Shogun Assassin. They change up some musical cues and add a narration by Daigoro.
And he was the Shogun's decapitator. He cut off the heads of 131 lords.
I would broadly say that Lone Wolf and Cub influenced Ninja Scroll from just the sheer stylized violence and fountain of blood spray. And I know that it's not exclusive to Lone Wolf and Cub, and a lot of movies were doing something similar at the time, but Lone Wolf and Cub just does it masterfully. More specifically, I couldn't say that any of these scenes directly influenced the creation of Ninja Scroll, but at a brief glance, if we string them all together, you can definitely see some similarities.
Could we cut to the chase?
First off, I would say that the main villain of all 6 movies is Yagyu Retsudo. So we've got another Yagyu in the house, and this one's seen as like the conniving shadow side of the Yagyu family trying to attain power. Which sounds an awful lot to me like the Shogun of the Dark concept in Ninja Scroll, right? Also in the first movie, we've got a scene where a woman is offering herself sexually to the lead character, and not out of love, but out of honor, and this seems very similar to the Kagero Jubei dynamic in Ninja Scroll.
That much I know. Tell me what I don't know.
Over the course of 6 movies, we see a deadly assassin woman covered in tattoos, similar to Benasato, maybe?
That's your destination, stranger.
That chick would bite Count Dracula on the neck.
We see underwater subterfuge. There's a hot spring scene. Snow. The riverboat. The bamboo glade, the fiery hold of a burning ship. In the 6th movie, there are some baddies that get resurrected after being dead for weeks, so we have the reincarnation angle too.
Reincarnation?
Lone Wolf and Cub, as well as 5 element ninjas, really formed the base for G.I. Joe and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles in American children's minds, and primes us for when Ninja Scroll hits in 1996.
I'll buy that. So now tell me what you want.
Well, I keep mentioning that the director of Shogun Samurai also directed another Yagyu Jubei vehicle with Sonny Chiba in 1981, Samurai Reincarnation. But for proper context, we have to back up just one more time.